Governor, thank you for your leadership, and thank you for setting the pace for us for so many years. I'm excited about what's ahead. I also want to introduce my wonderful wife, who has been working hard across the state, particularly with childhood literacy. And I'm going to bring her up here in a minute to talk about Reach Out and Read. But if my wife, Kristen Cooper, could stand up, please. Thank you. And when you think about somebody like Governor Hunt, I think about our success in North Carolina. And it has been built because of forward-thinking leaders, both in business and government and in our nonprofit communities. But when you think about Harry Sanford and Jim Holzhausen and Frank Porter Graham, Bill Friday, and of course, Jim Hunt, and think about the things they have built. Our universities, our community colleges, the Research Triangles Park, Smart Start, a model for early childhood education. Think of those things and what it's helped to make us. But when you think of them, at the core of each and every one of them is education. As I've said so many times about North Carolina, education is not only required by our state constitution, it is in our DNA as North Carolinians. It is part of who we are. The first state university in this country to open its doors, a university supported by the public. Community colleges close by to everyone, so that they can get the training that they need. The reason that education has been at the core of all of these developments is because it has created opportunities. It has helped make the American dream for so many people, bringing people from poverty into the middle class, bringing people to a successful life. I think even back then, with all of the foresight that they had, I think they probably didn't know that education would become more important than ever here in the 21st century. That soon, 67% of our workforce is going to require education past high school. We work to get kids graduated from high school, but they're going to need even more than that. That CEOs from all over the world would be telling this North Carolina governor in 2018 that a quality, skilled workforce was their number one priority, their number one need. So here we are in 2018. We're talking about education and demanding that our workforce knows more than ever. So what do we do? Well, coming into this governor's office, I have a CEO mission statement that many of you have heard me repeat. But it is a mission statement that I say over and over. I talk to my cabinet members, my staff, I remind them of it. And it is this. I want a North Carolina where people are better educated, where they're healthier, where they have more money in their pockets, and they have the opportunities to live a more abundant and purposeful life. That's it. That's my mission statement for our state. I go to a lot of our schools. I try to go to about a public school every week. It seems like that's about how many times I go. I was telling my mission statement to third graders the other day. You know what they like the best? The more money in their pockets. But that's good. I appointed, I believe, the most talented cabinet in the history of our state. It is by far the most diverse cabinet in the history of our state. I truly believe that state government should look like the people that it serves and protects. And I believe that diversity is our strength. In order to reach this mission statement, we have to emphasize quality education. And I have a goal. I believe that North Carolina can be, should be, and has to be a top 10 educated state by 2025. And we've got some measurables that we're looking at. High school graduation, the percentage of kids in pre-K, percentage of people who achieve post-high school attainment. Those are measurables that we have to work on. So what do we need to do there? And we need to go back to a more full and robust teaching fellow scholarship program to attract those teachers into the system. The legislature has made some small moves back toward it, but it needs to do even more in order to get these teachers. We know about the rural-urban divide. Many of you heard about the announcement of my Hometown Strong initiative last week. We also know about the divide among kids, poor kids struggling to get a basic education. We also know about the Leandro ruling that required a good teacher in every classroom and a good principal in every school in order to help deliver that sound basic education. And I formed the Leandro Commission as a result of an agreement between plaintiffs and defendants in that case. And we are going to work with a consultant to make a proposal before the court as a settlement to make sure that we do what we need to do to get a good teacher in every classroom and a good principal in every school, in all of our schools of North Carolina, no matter how poor, no matter how small. We need to make sure that we continue funding better than ever our community colleges and our universities. We know that they have been our economic engine. We know we're already in the top 10 of our universities and community colleges in this country. But we have to keep it up. I fear sometimes that we are resting on our reputation. We have to renew our effort. And we also have to remember, as we consider education, that there are societal issues that affect that child from the moment of birth, and sometimes even before birth. We have to think about that whole child as we approach education. We have to think about affordable housing and health care and drug dependency and the opioid crisis and violence and discrimination and the fact that we have smart, young, very poor kids who are kids of color who get passed over for advanced placement when they shouldn't because their scores show they should be there. So we have all of that that we need to address, and we can talk about each one of those issues for days. And I feel like I have been, but I think it's important for us to address them. But I think it's important today to remember that overall, we have to start at the beginning. Study after study after study, research after research after research tells us time and again that early childhood education matters. It matters a lot. There is a demonstrable, quantifiable difference between kids who get it and kids kids who don't. For business folks, there is a real return on investment, a measurable return on investment. There is a bang for the buck with early childhood education. But even if you don't believe the research, even if you don't believe the studies that time and time and time again show this is the case, go ask people that are involved in the process. I challenge you to ask any kindergarten teacher if he or she can tell whether a kid has had early childhood education or not, whether a kid has had pre-K. They can tell you. Because I ask them, I go to schools frequently, and I ask them, and when I raise the question, I go, oh, because they know. One teacher talked to me about a kid who did not even know how to hold a pencil. Another kid who doesn't know letters or numbers. And when you think about that challenge that a kindergarten teacher has, when you look at the division of knowledge in a kindergarten classroom, you know, just ask any of the CEOs, some of them who are speaking at this forum today, who physically took time away from their jobs, major technology companies in North Carolina, major financial companies in North Carolina, went down to the legislature and said to them, we have to eliminate the waiting list for pre-K. They need a workforce today, but they're smart enough to know that the workforce of tomorrow will not be there for them if we don't start early. Just ask them the importance of early childhood education. Ask any third grade teacher who's trying to make sure that a child knows how to read and tracking that child's progress from coming into kindergarten, there is still a demonstrable difference between kids who have had early childhood education and those who have not. Smart Start. It is partnerships across the state where business and nonprofits are involved, making local decisions about wise investments. That's why I provided more than $15 million for Smart Start in my last budget, which would have been the first increase since the recession in 2008. We have to do that. Fewer than 25% of our kids are enrolled in pre-K. There is a wait list. These CEOs and others who pushed were successful in getting the legislature to approve 1,800 more slots this year, but thousands are waiting. And there aren't even enough classrooms yet. There aren't even enough slots that have been created. We have to do that. Now let me tell you about a very important issue that is having an effect on pre-K, and not only pre-K, but public education as a whole. The legislature passed a law that required a reduction in class size for grades K through 3. That sounds like a good idea on paper. If you don't pay for it, it causes chaos. And what has happened is that the legislature has not paid for it. And I just had a dozen school superintendents around me at my table the other day. They didn't know what they were going to do. Because here are their choices. They're having to decide whether to take teachers from pre-K and put them in K through 3, and increasing class sizes for pre-K, or maybe even eliminating pre-K slots. And they're having to think about putting more kids than ever in fourth grades and above. I talked to a superintendent the other day where an eighth grade teacher retired. They had 3 8th grade classes, but they're not going to hire another one because they've got to meet this class size mandate, and now there are only two eighth grade classes, and as you can imagine, it's bulging at the seams. And where are they going to put all the classes? They're all talking about going to their county commissioners, asking for funding for mobile units, and almost every system in the state will be asking for mobile units. And they talk about the fact that they can't even make them that fast, so what's that going to do to the price? And not to mention art classes and music classes and PE classes. I walked into a classroom in Wake County, an elementary classroom, where they were on computers. The kids were learning coding, computer technology. And the principal looked at me and said, if they don't do something about this class size issue, this room is gone. Nothing I can do about it. We've got to fix it. We've got to fix it. Folks, there's no time to waste when it comes to early childhood education. I spoke to my high school, Northern Nash High School in Rocky Mount, North Carolina, and spoke to the graduating class and told them that over the half of the jobs that they would have an opportunity to get hadn't even been invented yet. We have to have a critical skill thinking education system that handles that. One research report just came out saying that 85% of the new jobs in 2030 haven't been invented yet. There is no time to waste. All right, we can all say these are good things, but business folks in the room and others who deal with this ask this important question. How are we going to pay for it? How are we going to do this? Number one, what's your priority? What's your priority? I tell people the old adage of show me your budget and I can see your priority. I'm not going to listen to you anymore, because I'm just going to look at your budget and I will see your priority. We need business people in North Carolina to use their political capital on these education issues. And we need to make sure that we have the state revenue to do what we need to do. Now, I'm not going to stand here and tell you about raising taxes, because I'm not advocating that. However, this General Assembly has continued to cut personal income tax, which mostly favors the wealthy because we have a flat tax. And they have continued to cut the corporate income tax, even though we are the lowest in the Southeast. And I do the business, I'm the chief econ recruiter for this state, and I talk to the businesses, and that's not the issue. The issue is skilled workforce. The issue is where their kids and where their workers are going to go to school. That is what matters. We need the business community to come in and say, stop. Because there are more cuts going into effect in 2019. And if you listen to my state budget director, Charlie Caruso, who will analyze the budget for you, he is showing a structural deficit in the coming years. And when we do that, how are we going to get our teachers' salaries to the national average? How are we going to invest in early childhood if we don't say, enough is enough? We don't want to be like some of those Midwestern states that have cut their tax base so much that, for example, in Oklahoma, many of the schools, they're going to school 4 days a week because they don't have money to pay them to go 5 days a week. That is unacceptable. That is not North Carolina. It is not the North Carolina. So we need you. We need the business community to say to the legislature, education is number one. Our workforce course, is number one. Investment in early childhood and pre-K, and investment in our public schools, community colleges, and universities has to be a priority over anything else. That is what I am hearing. And yes, we have to work hard to make sure that taxpayer money is invested wisely. And yes, we need to be bringing businesses into the classroom and getting teachers out into the business world. And we're working on a lot of these efforts to make sure. But we've got to have the basic support. All kids deserve an opportunity. President Bill Frye used to sometimes gather college students around. And I know that there are a lot of people in here who were educated, either in our community college system or in our university system. I'm standing in front of a sign that says NC State University here, and I'm very proud of that. Even though I heard a joke about ranch chops for lunch the other day, which didn't happen to. Delayed laughter there. That's good. But he would bring those students in, and he would say, over a million people in this state who live around the poverty line go to work every day. They pay sales taxes. They pay money into the general fund, which has helped fund your education. What are you going to do to pay them back? What are you going to do to pay them back? That's what I would ask us today. What are we going to do to pay these kids back? Are we going to give them the opportunities? I mean, particularly when you look at some of these kids, the circumstances in which they are born, poverty, drugs, violence, discrimination. Education is their way out. Early childhood is their way out. And yes, we have to help them with surrounding services, health care, and counseling, and affordable housing, but education is their way out. We owe our business community a great workforce. We owe these kids a great life. I would ask that you consider your choice as you leave today. The children of this state, our children, need us. Thank you very much, sir.